One, and thanks for staying with us. You know, it's Wednesday morning and time right now for our morning cup of Joe, and we have Undersheriff Kevin McMahill joining us over Skype today. Good morning, Undersheriff. It's great to have you. Hope you're doing well.
Thanks for having me. How cute was Simone there with the Pledge of Allegiance?
I know it. That was so cute. We've had great submissions, so lots of style there. You know, Undersheriff, there's been less traffic, obviously, the last few weeks, but it sounds like there's been an uptick in street racing. So what issues are you guys seeing on the road right now?
Yeah, I mean, excessive speed has really been pretty common. People are used to being inside of that gridlock traffic here, and so we've seen an increase in speed, and obviously the fatality accidents haven't really subsided for us as well, and so we're certainly asking people to slow down, pay attention to their surroundings. The question you're asking specifically on those speed racers, though, I can tell you that about 2 years ago, we were having trouble with these trick riders, the motorcycles that would go and take over entire parts of town. Car clubs would do the same thing, and so we went to the legislature. We had a law passed last year that's called trick riding. It's a gross misdemeanor. So we went out when we started getting reports of these events taking place with as many as 300, 400, 500 different vehicles, and really irresponsible behavior. We had some video where a father and a son on a bicycle almost got killed by an individual doing the donuts in the parking lot. And so we dusted off those plans, went back into action. We issued 300 citations at the latest event, impounded a number of cars, and so we're trying to also continue with that education that this behavior is just not acceptable, and we'll continue to focus on it.
Wow, 300 citations. All right. Several Metro officers, we understand, have tested positive for COVID-19. So how are they doing this morning, and how has all of this really changed day-to-day operations for you guys?
You know, so Metro with 6,000 people, obviously we're a very large organization. To date, although I have not looked at today's numbers, we're at 24 of our officers that have tested positive for the COVID virus. 14 of them have gone back to work. Out of those 24, we've only had one that has had to actually be hospitalized for any lengthy period of time. So we're doing well, and I attribute that to us getting out in front of this very early. When, you know, we're cops. We don't really understand what this virus meant at the very beginning of this, at seven, eight weeks ago. So we started working with the health professionals. We started working with the county. And obviously, we had done things like shut down our police records building, which we just reopened up yesterday along with our area commands. And so PPE for officers, call screening, hygiene and disinfectant of vehicles, all kinds of things that has really been a normal part of policing for a long time because we always deal with people with infectious disease. However, we've really stepped that up, and masks are optional for our officers, with the exception of within the Clark County Detention Center, because a significant number of those employees that tested positive came out of there. So our folks that work in the jail are all having to wear masks, as well as the inmates. And we obviously had to create that social distancing within the detention center as well.
Okay, so masks are optional for patrol. Are they being given those masks if they do choose to use them?
Yes, they absolutely have them. We go through about 14 questions when somebody makes a call to Metro now, either 911 or 311. Once the initial information comes in, COVID screening basically is what it is, and so that additional information is provided to the officers. But thanks to the generosity of so many people within our community and our ability to order some of that stuff, we have plenty of supply on hand today. However, we're still accepting donations of the hand sanitizer, the masks, the gowns, those types of things.
Okay, that's good to know. With more and more people obviously still at home right now, is Metro seeing an increase in any particular type of crime?
So, you know, we're actually doing pretty good, and let me give you the statistics since the COVID virus started. We're down in murder, rape, and robbery at over 20% in each one of those categories. The one disturbing trend that we're seeing is that we have an increase in the aggravated assaults with firearms in particular, as well as the knives and the hands, fists, and feet category, which encompasses the domestic violence. And so around a 12% increase in the domestic violence piece, but the northeast part of town, we have significant issues going on with gun violence, and we've adopted some strategies to change our deployment up there, and we're starting to make some headway back in that as well.
All right, we have just a few seconds left. Domestic violence calls, Undersheriff, are up right now. We're hearing that from different groups. Are you seeing that from Metro side as well? And what does Metro do to help anyone who is in a domestic violence situation?
Yeah, so the calls for service are up about 20%, or I'm sorry, the reports are about 20%. We're working with all of our service providers, educating folks. We're really trying to get out and making sure that people have an understand. Take a break from one another. Get away from one another. Give yourselves an opportunity to calm down a little bit. But we are responding to every single one of those calls in the same way that we always have. And we're imploring all of our additional resources around the valley to provide the services to those victims in the cases of domestic violence.
All right, Undersheriff Kevin McMahill, thanks so much for joining us. Hope you're doing well at home today, and thanks for all Metro does as well for our community. We appreciate you guys.
Appreciate it.